believe Huawei is one of TSMC's biggest customers, correct?
It used to be one of TSMC's biggest customers until U.S. sanctions on it in 2020.
But so now Huawei can't buy any TSMC chips?
It needs a special license from the U.S. Commerce Department to do so. And so the key product that Huawei used to produce at TSMC, which was the processor in each Huawei smartphone, is now de facto off limits. And so Huawei is no longer an important customer to TSMC.
How does the U.S. Commerce Department control what a Taiwanese company can sell to a Chinese company?
Yeah, that's a key question. So under the Trump administration, the U.S. tried to ramp up controls on Huawei by solely restricting the sale of U.S.-produced goods to Huawei. But that didn't really work because Huawei could turn to South Korean firms or Taiwanese firms to get around those restrictions. And so then they changed U.S. export control rules by introducing what's called the foreign direct product rule. And what that means is that any good abroad produced with U.S. technology is therefore subject to export controls. And so TSMC's facilities are full of U.S. technology, the types of machine tools I mentioned that can only be produced in the United States. And so TSMC has no choice but to impose U.S. export control rules on any company in the world, because if it doesn't do that, it's in violation of U.S. law. And if it violates U.S. law, it can't get the tools that it needs. So because it's basically impossible to make a chip anywhere in the world, at least an advanced chip, without U.S. tools and software, the entire world's semiconductor facilities have to apply U.S. export control law, regardless of where they're based, even facilities in China.
Interesting. So what is Huawei doing now that it can't get chips from TSMC? Or I guess there's Samsung, but that's basically it.
Yeah, and Samsung is subject to the same rules.
Right. So like what is poor Huawei to do?
Well, it's been a real problem for Huawei. They've had to divest a number of business lines. They've divested their smartphone business line, their cloud computing business line. They're trying to rejig their technology so it operates with less advanced chips, working with some Chinese producers who are able to produce for them. But the reality is the company is now a shadow of its former self because of these U.S. restrictions.
So it sounds like the Trump administration saw Chinese acquisition of semiconductors as a threat to national security. Was that a departure from previous administrations?
You know, it was to an extent, but I think there's really a lot of continuity between where the Obama administration was heading, where the Trump administration ended up, and where the Biden administration has continued policies. From 2014, when Xi Jinping made a number of key policy statements on semiconductors, from the initiation of the Made in China 2025 policy that we mentioned earlier, and as a result of the ongoing Chinese military buildup, which has really narrowed the gap in military terms between the U.S. and China, there's been kind of growing concern over the past decade in the U.S., both about Chinese advances in general, but about semiconductors in particular. And in the Defense Department in the U.S., there's a strong belief that semiconductors are crucial to the future of military power, whether it's autonomous drones or advanced electronic warfare systems, processing power, memory capacity, signals processing, all of which depend crucially on semiconductors, are also going to be fundamental to the future of warfare. And so as China was narrowing the gap technologically with the United States and dramatically increasing its role in the global chip industry, there was a lot of concern in the U.S., regardless of administration, that this was also going to bleed into an increased Chinese military capacity in the future.
So has the U.S. kind of slowed down China's military progress by putting these restrictions on ultimately chips from TSMC and Samsung?
I think the honest answer to that question is that it's hard to measure right now. We'll probably know in a decade's time what the effect has been. But if in terms of actual hard data to answer that question, we don't have that much. You can certainly find people who will give you a strong view based on their ideological priors, but it's a really difficult question to measure.
Yeah, that's what we want from you, just pure speculation based on your pre-existing biases.
I was actually wondering about U.S. companies doing business in China, because how much were U.S. companies involved in helping build the China semiconductor industry?
They were very involved, in part because U.S. companies are involved in inevitably in building any country's semiconductor technology. The nature of the U.S. role in the chip industry is such you really can't build a chip industry without a fair amount of U.S. involvement. And so in a lot of the key Chinese companies like SMIC, which is the biggest Chinese manufacturer of semiconductors, U.S. Firms and former employees of U.S. firms were really crucial in the early stages. I think over the last decade, that's begun to shift, both as U.S. firms have gotten more skeptical about their ability to make money in partnerships with Chinese firms, and because the political signals and the regulatory risk have gotten a lot more concerning. And so we've had a partial bifurcation beginning in the industry, whereas in the past, there was really a lot of back and forth between U.S. and Taiwanese and Japanese and Chinese firms. Now there's a lot more skepticism about interaction because of the regulatory risks involved on the U.S. side, and because there's growing worry or concern that it's very difficult for foreign firms to make money in China, given the government's focus on promoting domestic champions.
Can you talk a little bit about how joint ventures and technology transfer played a part in this?
Yeah, here too, I think you need to look at specific joint ventures to know what happened in any given situation, because there's a whole lot of variety as to how they worked. One European semiconductor executive that I spoke with told me that whenever he heard a Chinese partner say, let's make a joint venture, he heard, let's find a way to lose money together, because he believed they were never profitable at all for either party. Other joint ventures have been quite profitable for foreign firms because they've involved local governments or provincial governments providing huge subsidies to foreign chip firms to set up facilities in their locality or province. So there's a lot of variability based on which specific joint venture we're talking about. But one of the key themes in the reassessment of joint ventures from a political perspective in, among Japanese leaders, U.S. leaders, Taiwanese leaders, is the concern about forced technology transfer, whereby Chinese partners would start a joint venture and then the Chinese government would come in and try to push the foreign firm to transfer technology to the Chinese partner. And this is something that has been a growing worry among foreign investors in China, which is one of the reasons why we've seen a pretty marked slowdown, almost a complete halt, really, in large-scale foreign investment in the Chinese semiconductor industry.
Well, how much of China's semiconductor industry do you think was built by IP theft?
You know, I think IP theft alone is not the crucial driver. There is some IP theft. There are a couple of high-profile examples of it, but much more difficult to police than IP theft is forced technology transfer, which is not about IP, but about know-how and expertise. And the concern in a number of cases is that China's government was getting involved in ways that stepped outside normal business practices to push foreign firms to transfer this knowledge that they otherwise wouldn't have wanted to transfer. It's clearly been part of what's driven China's growth. I don't know that it's been the most important factor at all. And I think there's plenty of reasons to have expected that even if the Chinese government wasn't involved in its chip industry, China would still have had a growing footprint just because of how involved it is in the electronics industry in general. But we've certainly seen a number of very high-profile examples of attempted or successful forced technology transfer over the past couple of years, which has really changed the tenor of the debate, both in the foreign chip industry and also among foreign governments.
Well, how does that play out exactly? Like the Chinese government is telling the foreign firm that's doing a joint venture in China, like, you know, what you have to show our Chinese managers how to run the machines, like that sort of thing?
That's certainly one way it can happen. There's a big question as to who actually operates systems when there's a facility in China. Is it Chinese versus foreign workers? And we've seen a number of examples in the past where foreign firms set up a facility in China, but it's foreign workers who are actually doing the hard jobs, which is a deliberate strategy to keep that expertise in-house and not let it spread. And so if you do have more of a localization of the workforce, you also have more localization of the expertise as a result. And the Chinese government has sort of understandably in some ways been pushing for more localization of expertise, in some ways using legitimate means, in some ways using illegitimate means. We've had numerous examples, for example, of bogus court cases, for example, being brought against firms that weren't doing enough localization to appease the local government in a number of cases.
Right. And there's also one of the things you mentioned in the book is Chinese firms hiring like Americans and other foreigners to come work for the Chinese companies and bring their expertise.
That's right. That's right. I think there's some uncertainty as to how great of a strategy that actually is. We know that Chinese firms pay quite high salaries to recruit Taiwanese or South Korean or Japanese or American executives to their firms. How much technology transfer actually transfers is not always that certain. And there are a number of pretty high profile cases where a Chinese firm paid a lot of money to bring a chip executive in from abroad and then ended up failing a couple years later, suggesting that that's far from a silver bullet for technology transfer.
Well, there's one kind of hilarious example. I think it was Grace Semiconductors that was established that by leader Jiang Zemin's son and some Taiwanese guy. And then they hired George W. Bush's brother, Neil Bush, as a consultant for $400,000 a year. And I'm sure, you know, Neil had a lot of expertise in semiconductors.
No doubt. No doubt. And I think the more you dig into the Chinese chip industry, especially in its more in recent years where the government's played a bigger role, the more you find political connections like that being more important. And it makes sense because today, accessing government subsidies and getting the government on your side in terms of pushing your products is really important for selling things to the Chinese market. Whereas in the past, if you were a Chinese firm, you were focused primarily on exports. So you had to have good products at low prices. Today, it's a different commercial dynamic in China, and that incentivizes a lot more focus on the politics rather than on the technology.